thank you, President Bastides, for that kind introduction, for this great honor, and for your exemplary leadership of the University of South Carolina these past 5 years. I should start by addressing the many parents here today. No doubt you're justifiably proud of what your son or daughter has accomplished and your own contribution to getting here. The final tuition check is cleared. The final parking ticket has been paid. And I suspect many of you parents are already thinking about how to spend some of your newly reacquired disposable income. Forget it. I can tell you from experience, the National Bank of Mom and Dad is still open for business. Now to the class of 2013, congratulations on your great achievement. I'm grateful for the privilege of being your commencement speaker, and to show my thanks, I will keep my remarks short. George Bernard Shaw once told an orator that he had 15 minutes to speak. The orator protested, "How can I possibly tell them all that I know in 15 minutes?" And Shaw said, "I advise you to speak very slowly." As someone who has officiated over some 40 commencements as the university president, I know full well that at this point of the ceremony, I'm about the last thing standing between you, your diploma, and a great party. Now, typically, a graduation speaker is expected to share some advice on how to succeed in life. I could quote the billionaire J. Paul Getty, who offered sage wisdom on how to get rich. He said, "Rise early, work late, strike oil." Or as the famous film director Alfred Hitchcock once explained, "There's nothing to win, really. That is, if you happen to be blessed with a keen eye, an agile mind, and no scruples whatsoever." Well, instead of those messages, my only words of advice for success today come from two great women. First off, the star Beverly Sills, who once said, "There are no shortcuts to any place worth going." And Katharine Hepburn, who wrote, "Life is to be lived. If you have to support yourself, you would bloody well find some way that is going to be interesting. And if you don't do that, you're sitting around wondering about yourself." I'd like to say just a few words about this place you've called home these past 2 years. You've been fortunate to experience the unparalleled learning that takes place at the University of South Carolina. Learning enriched by the teaching and research that has made American higher education the envy of the world. In USC's Cathedrals of Excellence, what is discovered in the lab is taught in the classroom the next day. And in the case of Evista, also used to launch new companies and products. It is this blending of teaching and research that makes USC a special incubator of human talent, discovery, commerce, and innovation. Visiting a university campus always carries a very special personal meaning for me. It is a reminder of what so struck and moved me when I went from being a university president to the Secretary of Defense in the middle of two wars. As president of Texas A&M, I would walk the campus, probably like here, see thousands of students aged 18 to 25, typically wearing t-shirts, shorts, and backpacks. The day after I became Defense Secretary in December 2006, I flew to Iraq and visited our troops there. I was struck by the fact that nearly all of them were the very same age as the college students I've just left behind, except these 18 to 25-year-olds were wearing full-body armor, carrying assault rifles, living in awful conditions, and in harm's way. They were putting their dreams on hold so that you could pursue yours. Over the past decade, this generation of young included many Gamecocks in uniform. Their ranks most recently joined by the ROTC cadets from all the military service branches who will be receiving their officer commissions this spring. I'm told USC's Army ROTC program has more than tripled in size over the last 7 years, the third highest rate of growth in the country. A testament to the kind of young patriots this state produces and this university attracts. These cadets signed up knowing the very real sacrifices that might be required when volunteering in time of war. Long separations from family, exposure to danger, and in the case of Edward Murphy, class of 1991, and Jason Mann, class of 2005, making the ultimate sacrifice. The wars of those brave young men and women were sent to fight in Afghanistan and Iraq, many of them based on deployment orders I signed, were the most searing of a series of challenges that have made the last few years a difficult period for the United States. Indeed, for the first time in decades, we are dealing with a combination of prolonged unemployment, staggering debt, stagnant growth, and high budget deficits. America's leadership is being questioned on our way of life, challenged around the globe. Consequently, there's not been a lot of optimism in the air recently, especially when considering the state of affairs in Washington, D.C. these past few years. Over the course of nearly 5 decades in public life, I've been accused of many things. Being a starry-eyed optimist is not one of them. There's an old saying that when an intelligence officer smells the flowers, he looks around for the coffin. I was once referred to as the Eeyore of the National Security Establishment, looking for the darkest lining in the brightest cloud. Well, today, clouds may appear pretty dark, but the silver lining I see is this. While the obstacles to getting this country back on track are steep, we also have the means at our disposal to overcome them. Still, we cannot assume because things have worked out in the past that the problems we face will eventually resolve themselves. It will require the willingness our best and brightest young people from all walks of life, men and women like you, to step forward and bring your talents and your fresh perspectives to bear on the problems facing our country. So as you venture forth from this great university, I encourage you to discover for yourself what it is that drives you, what course or career path engages your head and your heart and your passion, and then pursue it with all your energy and all your commitment. But I also ask you to consider spending at least a part of your life in public service, to give back to the community, the state, and the country that have already given you so much. I entered public service 47 years ago, and no one is more familiar with its hassles, frustrations, and sacrifices. Government is, by design, slow and unwieldy. The Founding Fathers set up a system to protect liberty, not maximize efficiency. The humorist Will Rogers used to say, "I don't make jokes. I just watch the government and report the facts." As one moves up the career ladder to more senior positions in government, the vetting and selection process becomes only more intrusive, more acrimonious, and more politicized. I experienced this process many times, and usually compared it to receiving a root canal without anesthesia. But there is another aspect of public service about which Americans hear very little. The idealism, the joy, the satisfaction, and the fulfillment. I joined CIA in 1966 to defend our country against the former Soviet Union, and with any luck, helped bring down that entire rock construction. 25 years later, as director of CIA, I watched the Soviet Empire crumble, liberating hundreds of millions of people and ending what had been a mere constant threat of nuclear Armageddon. It was true closure. In the end, each person in public service has his or her own story and motives. But I believe that if you scratch deeply enough, you will find that those who serve, no matter how outwardly tough or jaded or even egotistical, are in our heart of hearts romantics and idealists and optimists. We actually believe we can make a difference, that we can improve the lives of others, that we can better the future of this country and this world. To serve your fellow Americans, to fulfill your responsibilities, your obligations as a citizen, you don't need to deploy to a war zone or move to a developing country or bury yourself in a cubicle by the Potomac River. You don't have to be a CIA operative or a Navy SEAL. But everywhere, because everywhere, there are children to be taught, veterans to be healed, roads to build, communities to strengthen, especially in these challenging times. In building a good business and staying involved in your community, you render public service in multiple ways. Yet no matter how many smart or talented individuals make up our government, in order to make progress in confronting America's most pressing problems, we need leaders able to make tough choices and to work together. Today's challenges will require America's political class to show leadership and make decisions that may be unpopular in the short run, but will strengthen the country for the long haul. Elected officials have to decide whether saving their seat, both literally and figuratively, is more important than saving the country. Invariably, those tough decisions will involve some measure of compromise. Too often, our political leaders have forgotten that it was compromise, many compromises, in fact, that created this Constitution and our country. Time and again, the founding fathers stood on principle whenever they could, yet came together when needed for the greater good. I will leave you with the words from the time of the founders. In this case, the founding families. During the American Revolution, Abigail Adams wrote her son and future president, John Quincy. And she said, these are the times in which a genius would wish to live. It is not in the still calm of life or the repose of a Pacific station that great characters are formed. Great necessities call out great virtues. We live in a time of great necessities. We need great leaders of character and of virtues. But I think the implications for your generation are best captured by the words of her husband, John Adams, writing to another son. He wrote, "The public business, my son, must always be done by somebody. It will be done by somebody or another. If wise men decline it, others will not. If honest men refuse it, others will not." As you prepare to go forth from this great institution, I ask the wise and the honest among you, the University of South Carolina class of 2013, to find new and inspiring ways to serve the American people and help make a better world. Congratulations. God bless and Godspeed.